Okay, so note that today we're going to review the life ahead, and the views expressed in this presentation are mine and mine alone. They do not necessarily express the views of Chabad of Arizona or Smile on Seniors. So with those legalities out of the way, let's get on to the movie, The Life Ahead. Based on the 1975 model, The Life Before Us by Romain Gary, Eduardo Ponte's 2019 Netflix adaptation, starring Sophia Loren as Rosa and a Senegalese boy rebel, Momo. She is a Holocaust survivor caring for children of sex workers, and Momo is the rebel. After a 70-year acting career and winning her first Academy Award in 1962, Sophia Loren is in the Oscar conversation once again for her starring role in The Life Ahead. Madame Rosa in French, and excuse my French, La Vie Devant Soi, is a 1977 French drama directed by Moshe Mizrahi. It starred Simone Signoret as Rosa and tells the story of an elderly Jewish woman and former prostitute in Paris who cares for a number of children, including an adolescent Algerian boy.
Dicono che tutto è scritto e non si può cambiare niente.
Sono uno e sono orfano.
Io voglio cambiare tutto.
Madame Rosa ha iniziato a tenere i bambini delle altre puttane.
Ciao! Rosa, ho bisogno di un favore. Mamma l'ho presa in affitto subito dopo la tragedia. Io non ce la faccio più, sono vecchio.
Due mesi, non un giorno di più.
Finché vivi qua, le regole le faccio io.
Nel quartiere questo posto lo chiamavano il rifugio. Io lo chiamavo un buco di merda.
Basta!
Io non posso andare, sai?
Non ci sta con la testa.
Rosa è un bambino.
Quella non è normale. È bacato dentro.
Tu finisci le parole. Sto qui.
Avevo la sua età.
Sto qui.
Era la prima volta che qualcuno mi trattava come una persona degna di fiducia.
Che
è proprio quando non ci credi più che succedono le cose belle.
Devi darmi una mano perché da solo non ce la faccio.
Se mi vuoi, sono qui.
L'umanità è solo una virgola nel grande libro della vita. Ma quando Madame Rosa mi guardava con i suoi grandi occhi gialli,
ma se vuoi,
non era una virgola.
Se mi vuoi, sono qui.
Ma il grande libro, tutto intero.
Nessuno ti vede, io sì.
I grappled with the name of the movie, The Life Ahead. Why does Momo smile at the lioness at Rosa's funeral? Madame Rosa and Momo couldn't be more alike. No matter their initial struggles at seeing each other's true selves. Rosa, an old Holocaust survivor, runs a daycare where Momo is forced to live after he tries stealing from her. Momo, a 14-year-old Senegalese immigrant, has seen enough not to chase happiness. He just wants a quick money and a thrill of rebellion to enjoy life. Yet, their worlds collide, and after the initial spitfire, they go from chasing and yelling at each other to becoming near fugitives in the basement of their own home. as Rosa's health and memory fizzles, but she refuses to stay in the hospital. When Rosa finally dies, Momo's imaginary lioness friend pays him a visit after being gone for a while, and he smiles at her. The reason? He has found the home his heart has been chasing after. After spending a few days cooped up inside the basement of the building and taking care of Rosa throughout, Momo finally gets caught by Rosa's neighbor while he's trying to sneak water into their hideout. When Momo runs to the room Rosa is resting in, shuts the door behind him and breaks into sobs as Rosa's lifeless body comes into focus, lying on the makeshift bed in the basement. The next scene shows Rosa's funeral. As the final rites are being performed, we see a decent enough crowd. There's Dr. Cohen, who was treating the immigrant boy and knew of his coping mechanism, lioness. He was the one who sent Momo to Rosa after the boy returned the stolen goods to the doctor. Under Rosa's care, Momo also grew to have a sense of family for the first time in his life. As much as he loves rebelling and earning fast cash through drug peddling, Rosa's care got him a respectable job at a local rug seller, thereby adding another caring figure into Momo's life. Momo also got acquainted with Rosa's loving neighbor, and his circle grew to two younger peers in the children under Rosa's care. Having grown up running from his father, who killed his mother for refusing to continue with her sex work, his sense of love and belonging was something Momo induced into his life through the overly affectionate lioness he had crafted as an imaginary friend. The lioness was the mother he so dearly missed, probably why the figure decided to take some time off as Rosa and Momo's relationship grew stronger. Finally, at Rosa's funeral, the lioness reappeared, but this time it's almost if Momo could see Rosa in her. He knew he was safe, surrounded by people he could come home to, and therefore the scene fades off with him smiling at the animal. Eduardo Ponti's directorial is not a perfect movie, but still a fitting tribute to Sophia Loren's genius that turns it into a tale of intransient pain and intermittent solace. The film's message of tolerance brought her back to acting, but that need for a personal connection to her work also made her selective when it came to the projects. The veteran actor lifts up the entire production from the claws of mediocrity and turns it into a tear-jerking tale of intransient pain and intermittent solace. An examination of the human condition and the human need for true companionship, the movie does best when Lorraine is in her element. Rosa is a fiery, self-confident old woman who tries to put a lid on her troubled past, but in vain. Lorraine captures her deepest anxieties artfully, and she grapples with her memories from Auschwitz. Rather than being a constant reminder of her troubled childhood, these memories serve as a harsh reminder that her being has been altered irrevocably since her tryst with a truly ugly. As the film commences, the past refuses to dissipate. Instead, it chooses to weigh down on her like a bag of bones, putting her in a state of perpetual insecurity, dragging her down the hellish depths of dementia. Although Madame Rosa is Jewish and sometimes makes racist comments about Momo, and she raises Momo as a Muslim in respect of his heritage, taking her to her friend Mr. Hamil for instruction in religion, she is in fact concealing the fact that Momo is 14, having a strong skepticism of official papers and what they can or cannot prove, and as a result, unable to send him to a regular primary school. Momo steals a dog from a pet shop. He later impulsively sells the dog for 500 francs and stuffs the money into the sewer. Rosa, who regards Momo as a troublemaker, takes him to her physician, Dr. Cohen, under the belief that he is mentally ill. Momo later follows her after she's had a nightmare about the Auschwitz concentration camp, only to discover her hidden Jewish space under the staircase, and the two begin to develop a closer bond. Madame Rosa is in exceedingly poor health and begins experiencing dementia, at times having flashbacks to the Veld de Hive on July the 16th, 1942, where the Nazis rounded up the Jews in the palace velodrome, and falling back into the belief she will be arrested by the French police and sent back to Auschwitz. After a bad fall on the stairs, Dr. Cohen informs Momo that Madame Rosa has many health issues, including hypertension. She refuses to be hospitalized. Momo believes she should be euthanized. When told by Dr. Cohen that euthanasia contradicts French values, Momo replied, "He's not French, and that Algerians believe in self-determination." Momo's father, who spent time in an asylum after murdering Momo's mother, returns to try and collect Momo, but Madame Rosa tricks him into believing that she raised him as a Jew, and the father suffers from a fatal stroke. Momo is with Madame Rosa when she retreats to her Jewish space under the staircase to die, and is discovered with the body 3 weeks later. The aging screen veteran is complemented by the magnetic screen presence of Ibrahima Gueye, who plays the troubled 11-year-old Senegalese boy by the name of Momo. Also, the narrator of the story. Momo lost his mother when his father decided to kill her after she refused to prostitute herself. Living with Dr. Cohen, he is a juvenile delinquent who meets Madame Rosa while trying to steal her handbag. After Dr. Cohen makes Momo return the stolen bag to Rosa, she takes him under her wings, albeit begrudgingly. The ensuing conflict between the two makes up for some of the genuinely heart-wrenching moments. Soon, the friction between them transforms into an unlikely alliance. Neither one can understand the other, and yet, when their worlds collide, the ever-throbbing pain of life and living cuts through their souls like a deep flesh wound, uniting them in their misery. Gouyer gets into his character shoes with much aplomb, often conveying more with his expressions and body language than with words. Momo is stuck in the brash, irrational behavior pattern of a juvenile youth, but also displays a softer side, a vulnerable kid incapable of expressing himself emotionally and in the dire need of affection from a motherly figure. The Life Ahead was filmed in Bari. I'm pointing it out here on the boot of Italy. The capital city of the Apulia region, the heel of the Italian boot. When Madame Rosa is very close to Bari's central train station, sorry, I repeat, the house of Madame Rosa is very close to Bari central train station at 208 Corso Cavour. For those of us who remember international travel, the area is a good place to visit the city, but a bit cramped as you have the elevated viaduct in the middle and there are too many cars everywhere. The filmmakers also set up here on the square in front of the house, the flea market where Momo robs Madame Rosa of her silver candlesticks. Hamil's antique shop is located in the heart of Bari's old city, Bari Vecchia. The beautiful medieval quarter is a maze of streets filled with the white houses characteristic of this region bordering the Adriatic Sea. Filming also took place in an old palace located in the historic center of Trani. We reckon that this house could have been the one used to shoot the interiors of the store. The scene when Momo is happy cycling his new bike under the palm trees was shot at the Giardino Corso Vittoria Emanuele, the boulevard that splits the old and the new city. Some establishing shots show the lighthouse Fora di Punta San Cataldo, tongue-tied, in the harbor. Pictured is the historical center with the imposing cathedral of San Sabino rising above the rooftops. The countryside house and the rural farm with a never-ending field of olive trees were filmed at the Masiera Brancati, located near the town of Ostumi in the Salento region. The Masiera is today a bed and breakfast occupying the old fortified rural farmhouse. The estate is situated in the middle of a centuries-old olive trees area called Marina de Astuni. The old town is known as the White City, Città Bianca, if you visit. A little history. Where is the Jewish cemetery in Bari? One of the oldest Jewish cemeteries in Apulia, dating back to the 8th century, is in Bari San Lorenzo district. Bari was once one of the flourishing Jewish centers of the Apulia, which, according to tradition, were founded by captives brought to Italy by Titus. However, unlike in neighboring towns, no inscriptions have survived to trace the community back to the Roman period. The community in Bari rose to importance at a later time. The epitaph dating back to the 9th century preserves the memory of Eliyahu ben Moshe, a devoted teacher of the law and a poet, compared to the biblical Moses. In the 9th century, the miracle worker Aaron of Baghdad visited Bari. The names of scholars who taught at the local rabbinical academy in the 10th and 11th centuries are recorded, including Moshe Kalfo, who is mentioned in the Aruch of Nathaniel Jahil. I can't pronounce that. Unlike other cities in the region of Apulia, there's now very few traces of Jewish presence in Bari, although we know that the community was very developed. The city was, in the 12th century, a recognized center of Talmudic studies. The Via della Sinagoga, which housed the place of worship of the community, now renamed Via Sabino, attests to the importance of the Jewish life in Bari. Note that in 1943, a number of Jews from Italy and Yugoslavia found refuge in Bari. At the end of the Second World War, a refugee camp was established there. Then, after 1945, the surrounding of Bari were a point of illegal departure toward Palestine. I would be remiss if I did not spotlight Sophia Loren, in my day, the most beautiful woman in the world. Sophia Loren, originally her name was Sophia Villani Sicilioni, born September the 20th, 1934 in Rome, Italian film actress who rose above her poverty-stricken origins in post-war Naples to become a universally recognized as one of Italy's most beautiful women and its most famous movie star. Before working in the cinema, Sophia Sicilioni worked for the Foto Maziani, a popular pulp magazine that used still photographs to depict romantic stories. Her first film role as an extra was one of the many slave girls in the American production of Quo Vadis in 1951. Under the tutelage of producer Carlo Ponti, her future husband, Sicilioni was transformed into Sophia Loren. Her career was launched in a series of low-budget comedies before she attracted critical and popular attention with Aida in 1953, in which she lip-synced the singing of Renato Tebaldi in the title role. Loren's beauty often overshadowed her enormous talents as an actress, but her earthly charisma is evident even in such early works as Vittorio De Sica's Leoro di Napoli in 1954, The Gold of Naples. With Ponti's help, Loren increased her international visibility by appearing in Hollywood films opposite such major stars as Cary Grant, Houseboat in 1968, Clark Gable, It Started in Naples, 1960, Frank Sinatra, The Pride and the Passion in 1957, also with Cary Grant, Alan Ladd, Boy on a Dolphin, 1957, William Holden, The Key, 1958, and Paul Newman, Lady L, in 1965. Such exposure was undoubtedly instrumental in helping her win an Academy Award for Best Actress in De Sica's 1960 movie, Two Women, in which she delivered a powerful performance as a courageous mother of a teenage girl during World War II. Madame Rosa is a 1977 French drama directed by Moshe Mizrahi, adapted from the 1975 novel, The Life Before Us by Romain Gray, 1914 to 1980. He was a French novelist, diplomat, film director, and World War II aviator of Jewish origin. Madame Rosa stars Simone Signoret and Sammy Ben-Yub and tells the story of the elderly Jewish woman caring for children of prostitutes after the war. While this movie has all the hallmarks of a true story, it isn't. The Life Ahead is an adaptation of the 1975 French novel La Vie devant soi, or The Life Before Us, by author Roman Gray. The book is set in France, while the new movie is set in Italy, but the plot remains the same. The story has been adapted twice before, including the 1978 Oscar winner for Best International Feature, Madame Rosa. While there isn't a real Madame Rosa or a real Momo to point to, there's a real story behind the book that is stranger than fiction. Gary, already a successful writer for many years, published The Life Before Us under the pseudonym of Emile Ajar. As reported by the BBC, Gary imagined Ajar as a 34-year-old Algerian man who had to flee France after performing a botched abortion as a medical student. After settling down in Brazil, Ajar became a writer and released his most well-known book in 1975. Keep in mind, none of this is real. To keep the ruse, Gary had a friend in Brazil help mail the manuscripts and had a relative, Paul Pavlovich, pretend to be Ajar for the interviews. For The Life Before Us, Ajar won the Prix Goncourt, a top literary prize in France. No writer is allowed to win the Prix Goncourt more than once. But because of his secret alter ego, Gary remains the only writer to have won twice. It was only publicly revealed that Gary was Ajar in 1981, the year following his death. As reported by the New York Times, people had just believed that Ajar was a pen name for Pavlovich, until Pavlovich revealed Gary was the real Ajar. A little bit complicated. If the drama and mystery of all of this intrigues you, then Gary's life as a whole probably will too. In the BBC article, it also pointed out that Gary faked aspects of his life in his autobiography. So, Lorraine is playing a fictional person written by a fictional author of sort. Lorraine actually knew the real Gary. She starred in the adaptation of his book, Lady L, along with Paul Newman in 1965. Now, 55 years later, she's bringing another one of his characters to life, and people are discovering the story of The Life Before Us and the story of Emile Ajar once again. I'd like to mention the original Madame Rosa movie back in 1977. The story and the movie are similar to The Life Ahead. You can watch this original Madame Rosa movie on YouTube. Just search for Madame Rosa, the movie. However, it is in French. It's a bad copy. The subtitles are white on white. And I would say if you watch 30 minutes, you'd get the gist. So lastly, mark this date in your calendar, January the 19th, 2021, for session 6. I'm going to stop sharing the screen.
Yeah, you can talk now.
Okay.
Very good presentation, Issy. Excellent. You did a hell of a lot of research.
Just a little bit. Thank you. Just let me get this up on a big screen here so I can see you all again. Gallery, there you are. Oh.
It was a marvelous movie that we just saw, that I just saw. And Sophia Loren is still a marvelous actress. And I also like the fact that she looks like she's getting old, like we are.
So,
don't you think it's interesting that the movie originally was The Life Before Us, and the Sophia Loren movie is the Life Ahead?
Yeah. Who knows? I don't know why they chose that. I also don't know why Eduardo, her son, would want to portray his mother, Sophia Loren, once the most beautiful woman in the world, as such an old woman.
Because beauty is from within.
Absolutely.
The interesting sidelight is the Academy Award she won for Two Women, that role was originally offered to Anna Magnani and she turned it down.
Oh, really?
You know, in most movies, when they offer a role to an actor or an actress, one or another turns it down and someone else takes it up and then they win the Oscar.
Right.
I just want to interrupt for 1 minute and then we'll get back to the movie. Tomorrow's talk is for men and women. Don't be shy. If anybody has a question that you don't really want to speak out on, I've put my email address in the chat. You're welcome to send me an email and we'll do it anonymously. So back to the movie.
Looking forward to it.
Aye.
Okay, so.
Thank you, Pinky.
Pleasure.
Yes.
This movie wasn't a real easy movie to get a lot of.
See, I have a question before you get into that. When you did your synopsis, there were two scenes you mentioned that I don't recall from the movie. One where Momo stole a dog and sold him, and one where his father came back to try to reclaim him. Did you get that from other sources?
It was in the movie.
The movie definitely shows where he stole the dog.
Okay.
He walked past a pet store. It was a little white puppy. And some woman walked up to him, offered him 500 francs for it. He took it, sold the dog, and then tossed the 500 francs in the sewer right away. Mm-hmm. The part of the story of his father was done through research. That wasn't in the movie at all. It was done through research.
So I was half right anyway.
That was in the first movie.
What?
For whatever it's worth, I don't remember the dog being in the movie either. But
okay. Thank you.
Time to rewatch the movie. So the movie has got a lot of press lately. And I'm just upset that we're in the situation now where you can't go to the theater, where it gets a big release. I'm wondering if she'll be nominated for an Oscar.
Probably.
Because they can't, whatever the Academy or whichever movies the Academy is going to nominate, they're not in the movie theaters. So it's got to be something that's online at the moment.
What does everybody think of Momo?
I thought Momo was spectacular. First of all, that smile of his. I thought that really something. So Momo is actually 17 years old. Believe it or not, he's 17. So the way the makeup departments and directors film actors that are much older than their characters, and the way they do that is just phenomenal. Mm-hmm. Phenomenal. Also bear in mind, the budget on this movie wasn't really big. It wasn't a very big budget movie. So that's why I did a little history on where it was filmed. I always like to know where these things are and what the places look like. So a lot of the scenes where the market was, where he was riding his bicycle, the olive fields, are not movie sets. They are real places. So that was of interest to me. And the other thing I also like to try and do is when we go through these movies is to get the Jewish history on it, where it was, why it was, and try to see what there was there. Maybe one day when we can travel again and you go to Italy, someone will go visit Bari.
We're not muted.
Yeah, not muted.
I thought it was called A Life Ahead because it didn't dwell at all on the past. there were a couple of sentences on each person's, you know, miserable past, but really the main thrust of the story was on what lied ahead from coming from such a terrible past.
I agree with you, Judy.
There's one before us.
And I think that, I think it was like kind of a miracle that they all intertwined. And there was some book I read years ago called Something About a Thread. And it was similar in the sense that unlikely people came together and changed their lives in such a wonderful way. And each one lacked something. And then the other person came in to fill it, you know, fulfilled their life in a better way. And just on one point on the movie is, she had wanted not to be in the hospital, but at the point mm-hmm. she was transported there, she would not have had a voice. So he came and took her on his own. That was tremendously brave, I thought, to fulfill her last wishes.
I think also the title, which bothered me in the beginning, The Life Ahead, for me, I think that refers to Momo, to his life ahead, because he got his guidance from Madame Rosa, and the significance of the lion, or the lioness, if it wasn't the significance of the lioness coming back. There was one scene when he was in the apartment when he was kind of caressing and wrestling with a lioness. And then in the end at the funeral, the lioness came back again and then disappeared, because his life had become fulfilled. That, I think that was a big part of the story.
You know,
that cross-dresser or transgender or whatever you call that, you know, I'm sorry, I'm not up on the terms. You know, they were each fulfilled by the people that they were involved with. So, you know, that's how I feel. It was about everybody's lives being changed from their past.
You know, in the 60-minute interview of Sophia Loren, they asked her, how did they get this young boy to act in the movie? And her son, Eduardo, said that they took him into their family and he lived with them for a period of time before they filmed the movie so that he could feel the part.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, great.
So I thought that was an interesting way of dealing.
Method acting.
Yeah, right, exactly.